Preface of Faery Lands of the South Seas. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Mike Vendetti. Faery Lands of the South Seas by James Norman Hall and Charles Nordhoff. Preface. The islands of the South Seas are places of an interest curiously limited. The ethnological problem presented by the native is interesting only to men of science. Commerce is negligible. There is little real agriculture and no industry at all. There remains the charm of living among people whose outlook upon life is basically different from our own, of living with a simplicity foreign to anything in one's experience, amid surroundings of a beauty unreal both in actuality and in retrospect. It is impossible to write of the islands as one would write of France or Mexico or Japan. The accepted viewpoint of the traveler is not applicable here. A simple attempt to impart information would prove singularly monotonous, and one is driven to essay a different task, to pry into the life of the mingling races, hoping to catch something of its significance and atmosphere. Making such an attempt, it is necessary at times to dig deeper than would be consistent with good taste if names were mentioned. And for this reason, in the case of certain small islands, the ancient Polynesian names have been used instead of those given on the chart. All of the islands described are to be found in the Panamutu Society and Hervey Groups, JNH, CBN, Tahiti, April 10, 1921. End of preface. One of Faery Lands of the South Seas. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Mike Vendetti. Chapter 1. A Leisurely Approach. I don't remember precisely when it was that Nordhoff and I first talked of this adventure. The idea had grown upon us, one might say, with the gradual splendor of a tropical sunrise. We were far removed from the tropics at the time. We were, in fact, in Paris, and had behind us the greatest adventure we shall ever know. On the Place de la Concorde, among the Champs-Élysées, stood rank on rank of German cannon, silent enough now, but still menacing, their muzzles tilted skyward, at that ominous slant one comes to know so well. For a month we had seen them so. Children perched astride them on sunny afternoons, rolling pebbles down their smooth black throats. Veterans in soiled and faded horizon blue, with the joy of this new quiet world bright on their faces, opening breech blocks, examining mechanism with the skill of long use at such employment, with a kind of wondering hesitation in their movements, too, as though at any moment they expected those sinister monsters in the fantastic colors of Harlequin to spring into life again. Those were glorious days. Never again, I think, will there be such a happy time as that in Paris. The boulevards are crowded, the tables filled under every awning in front of the cafes, and yet there seemed to be a deep silence everywhere, a silence intensified by the faint rustling of autumn leaves and the tramping of innumerable feet. One heard the sound of voices, of laughter, of singing, the subdued, continuous rumble of traffic, but not a harsh cry, not a discordant note. All the world seemed to be making holiday at the passing of a solemn, happy festival. Well, we had kept it with the others, Nordhoff and I have the memory of it now, to be enjoyed over and over again as the years pass. But there was danger that we might outstay the freshness of that period. We were anxious to avoid that for the sake of our memories, if for nothing else. While we were not yet free to order our movements as we chose, we pretended that we were, and so one rainy evening in the December following the armistice, we decided to call that chapter of existence closed and to go forward with the making of new plans. For we meant to have further adventure of one kind or another, adventure in the sense of unexpected incident rather than hazardous activity. That had been a settled thing between us for a long time. We had no craving for excitement, but turned to plans for uneventful wanderings, which we had sketched in broad outlines months before. They had been left of necessity vague, but now that any of them might be made realities, now that we had leisure and a reasonable hope of the fulfillment of plans, well, we had cause for a contentment which was something deeper than happiness. The best of it was that the close of the war found us with nothing to prevent our doing pretty much as we chose. We might have had houses or lands to anchor us, or promising careers to drag us back into the bewilderments of modern civilization. But fortunately or unfortunately, there were none of these things. The chance of war had given us a freedom far beyond anyone's desert. We had some misgivings about accepting so splendid a gift, which the event sometimes proves to be the most doubtful of benefits. Viewed in the light of our longings, however, our capacity for it seemed incalculable. And so, by degrees, we allowed our minds to turn to an old allurement, the South Pacific. It became irresistible the more we talked of it. Longing as we then were for the solitude of islands, the objection to this choice was that the groups of islands which we meant to visit have been endowed with an atmosphere of pseudo-romance, displeasing to the fastidious mind. But there was not the slightest chance of our being pioneers wherever we might go. We could not hope to see with the eyes of the old explorers who first came upon these far-off places. We must expect great changes, but much as we might regret for the purposes of this adventure that we had not been born 200 years earlier, comfort was not wanting to our situation. Had we been contemporaries and fellow explorers with Equeros and Cook or Bougainville, we should have missed the Great War. We came within view of Tahiti one windless February morning. Such a view as Pedro Fernandez de Quiros himself must have had more than 300 years before. The sky to the west was still bright with stars, and but barely touched with the very ghost of light, giving it the appearance of a great water, with a few clouds, like islands, immeasurably distant. Half an hour later the islands themselves lay in full sunlight, jagged peaks falling away in steep ridges to the sea, against sheer walls still and shallow in upland valleys. One could see a few terns, but there was no other movement, no sound, nor any sign of a human habitation. Nothing to shatter the illusion of primitive loveliness. It was illusion, of course, but the reality was nothing like so disappointing as I had feared it would be. Outwardly, 200 years of progress have wrought no great amount of havoc. There is a little port, a busy place on boat days, but when the steamer has emptied the town of her passengers, the silence flows down again from the hills. Off the main harbor front, thoroughfare streets lie empty to the eye for half hours at a time. Chinese merchants sit at the doorways of their shops waiting for trade. Now and then, broad pools of sunlight flow over the gaily flowered dresses of a group of native women, scarcely to be seen otherwise as they move slowly through tunnels of moist green gloom, or a small schooner, like a detail gifted with sudden mobility in a picture, will back away from shore, cross a harbor bright with the reflections of clouds, and stand out to sea. In the stillness of the noon siesta, one hears at infrequent intervals the resounding thud of ripe fruits as they tear their way to the ground through barriers of foliage. And at night, the melancholy thunder of the surf on the reef outside the harbor, and the slithering of bare feet in the moonlit streets. Coming from a populous exile, doubly attracted for that reason by the lure of unpeopled places, Nordhoff and I sought here an indication of what we might find later elsewhere. The few thousand of natives, whites, orientals, half-castes, live in a charmed circle of lowland fronting the sea, conscious of their mountains, no doubt, but the whites without curiosity, the orientals without desire, the natives without remembrance. There must have been a maze of trails in the old days leading down from the rich valleys. Now they are overgrown, untraveled, lost. Since the old life is no more than a memory, One is glad for the desolation and grateful to the French lack of enterprise, which surely is the only way to account for it. No, we couldn't have chosen a better jumping-off place for our unpremeditated wanderings. We had the whole expanse of the Pacific before us, or better, around us, and there was, as I have said, a harbor full of shipping. Boats with pleasing names like the Kyrieis, the Avora, the Porivavana, the Keo, the Lien, and self-confident seagoing aspect. Some tidy and smart with new paint and rigging, others with decks warped and sides blistered, bottom foul with the accumulation of 6 months' cruise, reeking with the warm odor of copra. Boats newly arrived from remote islands with crowds of bare-legged natives on their decks, their eyes beaming with pleasure in anticipation of the delights of the great capital, outward bound to the Marquesas, the Australs, the Cooks, the Low Archipelago, despite the fact that it was the middle of the hurricane season. Among these latter, there was one whose name was like a friendly hail from Gloucester or Portland, Maine. But it was not this which attracted me to her. For all its assurance of Yankee hospitality, she was off to the Potomacs, the Cloud of Islands, and longing to go there, persisted in the face of a number of vague discouragements. There were no practical difficulties, easy enough to get passage by one schooner or another. Paumotu Copra is famous throughout the southern Pacific. There is a good deal of competition for it, boats racing one another for cargo to the richer islands. The discouragements weren't so vague, either, now that I think of them. They came from men kindly disposed, interested in the islands in their own way. But their concerns were purely commercial. I heard a deal of talk about copra, in kilos, in tons, in shiploads. Its market value in Papeete, in San Francisco, in Marseille, until the stately trees which gave it lost, for a time, their old significance. Talk, too, of coconut oil and its richness in butterfat. Butterfat! There was a word to bring one back to a workaday world. To meet it at the outset of a long, dreamed-of journey was disheartening. It followed me with the shrill insistence of a creamery whistle, and I came very near giving up my plans altogether. Nordhoff did not change his. He said that it was silly, no doubt, but he didn't like the idea of wandering, however lonely, in a cloud of butterfat islands. Therefore, we said goodbye, having arranged for a rendezvous at a distant date, and set out on diverging paths. I ought to leave Crichton, the English planter, out of this story altogether. He doesn't belong in a commonplace record of travel such as this one set out to be. He had very little to do with the voyage of the Caleb S. Winship among the atolls. But when I think of that vessel, he comes invariably into mind. I see him sitting on the cabin deck, with his freckled brown hands clasped about his knees, looking across a solitude of waters. And in my mental concept of the Low Archipelago, he is always somewhere in the background, standing on the sun-stricken reef of a tiny atoll, his back to the sea, almost as much a part of the lonely picture as the sea itself. But one can't be wholly matter-of-fact in writing of these islands. They are not real in the ordinary sense, but belong rather to the realm of the imagination. And it is only in the imagination that you can conceive of your ever having been there, once you are back again in a well-plowed sea-track. As for the people, whether native or alien, in order to focus them in a world of reality, it is necessary to remember what they said or did, what they ate, what sort of clothing they wore. Otherwise, they elude you, just as the islands do. This point of view isn't perhaps commonly held among the few white men who know them, captains of small schooners, managers of trading companies, resident agents, whose interest, as I have said, is in what they produce rather than what they are. As one old skipper of my acquaintance put it, in speaking of the atolls, take them by and large. They are as much alike as the reef points on that sail. Finley's South Pacific Directory, a supposedly competent authority, bears him out in this. They are all of similar character, adding for emphasis, no doubt, and they exhibit very great sameness in their features. He does, however, make certain slight concessions to what may be his own private conception of their peculiar fascination. This vast collection of coral islands, one of the wonders of the Pacific, and later in his account of them, the native name Pumatu, signifies a cloud of islands, an expressive term. But he doesn't forget that he is writing for practical-minded mariners who want facts and not fancies, however truthful these may be to reality. "Now there's Taikohu," one of them said to me before I had been out there. "That's a small atoll, and Rehale, sort of square-like and so on, some with passes and a good anchorage inside the lagoon. Others you got to lay outside and take your cargo off the reef in a small boat." But to go back to Crichton, no one knew who he was or where he came from. The manager of the Inter-Island Trading Company had lived in Papeete for years and had never seen him until the day when he turned up at the waterfront trundling a wheelbarrow loaded with 4 crates of chickens and an odd lot of plantation tools and fishing tackle. Following him were 2 native boys carrying a weather-blackened sea chest and an old woman with an enormous roll of bedding tied loosely in a pandanus mat. That was about an hour before the schooner weighed anchor. He stacked his gear neatly on the beach and then went on board, asking for passage to Tanao. "No, sir," the manager said in telling about it afterward. "I never laid eyes on him until that moment, and I don't know anyone who had. Where's he been hiding himself, and why in the name of common sense does he want to go to Tanao? There's no copra or pearl shell there. Not enough anyway to make it worth a man's while going after it." Tino, the supercargo, was equally puzzled. "I know Tanao from the sea," he said. "Passed it once coming down from the Marquesas. When I was supercargo of the Tyre Tahiti, we were blown out of our course by a young hurricane. Didn't land. There's no one on the godforsaken place. Now here's this Englishman or Dane or Norwegian, whatever he is, asking to be set down there with 4 crates of chickens with an old Kanaka woman for company." He shook his head with a give-it-up expression, adding a moment later, "Well, you meet some queer people down in this part of the world. I don't believe in asking them their business, but it beats me sometimes trying to figure out what their business is." He was not able to figure it out in this case. The old woman was talkative, but the information he gathered from her only stimulated his curiosity the more. She owned Tanao, an atom of an atoll, miles out of the beaten track, even of the Paumotu schooners. There had never been more than a score of people living on it, he said, and now there was no one. Crichton had taken a long lease on it and was going out there, as he told me afterward, to do my writing and thinking undisturbed. I didn't know this until later, however. When I first heard him spoken of, we were only a few hours out from Papeete. We had left the harbor with a light breeze, but at 4 in the afternoon the schooner was lying about 15 miles offshore, lazy jacks flapping against idle sails with a mellow, crusty sound. After a good deal of fretting at the fickleness of land breezes, talk had turned to Crichton, who was up forward somewhere looking after his chickens. I didn't pay much attention then to what was being said, for I had just had one of those moments which come rarely enough in a lifetime, but which make up for all the arid stretches of experience. They give no forewarning. There comes a flood of happiness, which brings tears to the eyes. The sense of it is so keen. The sad part of it is that one refuses to accept it as a moment. You say, "By Jove, I'm not going to let this pass." And it has gone, as unaccountably as it came, half lost through foreboding of its end. One prepares for it unknowingly, I suppose, through months, sometimes years, of longing for something remote and beautiful, such as these islands, for example. And when you have your islands, the moment comes, sooner or later, and you see them in a light which never was, as the saying goes, but which is the light of truth for all that. Brief as it is, no one can say that the reward is ample, and it leaves an afterglow in the memory, tempting regret, fading very slowly, which one never wholly loses, since it takes on the color of memory itself. becoming a part of that dim world of worthwhile illusions, all of which has very little to do with what was passing aboard the Caleb S. Winship, except that I was prevented from taking an immediate interest in my fellow passengers. But this being my first near view of a Polynesian trading schooner, the scene on deck had all the charm of the unusual. Her skipper was a Paumotuan, a former pearl diver, and the sailors, six of them, including the mate, Tahitian boys. In addition to these were Crichton, the planter, the supercargo, master of three major languages, and a half-dozen Polynesian dialects, the manager of the Inter-Ireland Trading Company, William, the engineer, Oro, the cabin boy, a Chinese cook, and two Chinese storekeepers, evidence of the leisurely, persistent Oriental invasion of French Polynesia. 30 native passengers, a horse in an improved stall amidships, a monkey perched in the mainmast rigging, Christian's 4 crates of chickens, and 5 pigs. In addition to the passengers and livestock, we were carrying out a cargo of lumber, corrugated iron, flour, rice, sugar, canned goods, clothing, and dry goods. Each of the native passengers brought with him as much dunnage as an Englishman carries when he goes traveling, and his food for the voyage. Limes, oranges, bananas, breadfruit, mangoes, canned meat. With all of this, a 2-month supply of gasoline for the engines, and fresh water and green coconuts for the passengers and crew. We made a snug fit. Even the space under the patient little native horse was used to stow his fodder for the long journey. The women, with one exception, were barefooted, bareheaded, but otherwise conventionally dressed according to European or American standards. This, I suppose, is an outrageous betrayal of a trade secret, if one may say that writers of South Sea narratives belong to a trade. Those seriously interested in the islands have, of course, known the truth about them for years, but I believe it is still a popular misconception that the women who inhabit them, no one seems to be interested in the men, are, even to this day, half-savage, unself-conscious creatures who display attention of the others. And in a moment, men, women, and children had gathered around, laughing and shouting, throwing bits of coconut shell, mango seeds, banana skins, faster than the monkey could catch them. The spontaneity of the merriment did one's heart good. Even the old men and women laughed, not in the indulgent manner of parents or grandparents, but as heartily as the children themselves. Unconscious of the uproar, one of the Chinese merchants was lying on a thin mattress against the cabin skylight. Although he was sound asleep, his teeth were bare in a grin of ghastly suavity, and his left eye was partly open, giving him an air of constant watchfulness. He was dreaming, I suppose, of copra, of pearl shell, in kilos, tons, shiploads, of its market value in Papeete, in San Francisco, in Marseilles, etc. Well, the whites get their share of these commodities, and the Chinamen theirs, but the natives have a commodity of laughter, which is vastly more precious, and as long as they do have it, one need not feel very sorry for them. Dusk gathered rapidly while I was thinking of these things. Heavy clouds hung over Tahiti and Moorea, clinging about the shoulders of the mountains, whose peaks rising above them were still faintly visible against the somber glory of the sky. They seemed islands of sheer fancy, looked at from the sea. It would have been worth all that one could give to have seen them as De Quero saw them, or Cook, or the early missionaries, to have added to one's own sense of their majesty the solemn and more childlike awe of the old explorers, born of their feeling of utter isolation from their kind, with the presence of the unknown on every hand. It is this feeling of awe, rarely to be known by travelers in these modern days, which pervades many of the old tales of wanderings in remote places, which one senses in looking at old sketches made from the decks of ships, of the shores of heathen lands. The wind freshened. Then came a deluge of cold water, blotting out the rugged outlines against the sky. When it had passed, it was deep night. The forward deck was a huddle of shelters made of mats and bits of canvas, but these were being taken down now that the rain had stopped. I saw an old woman sitting near the companionway, her head in clear relief against a shaft of yellow light. She was wet through, and the mild misfortune broke the ice between us. if one may use a metaphor very inept for the tropics. With her face half in shadow, she reminded me of a typical Anglo-Saxon grandmother, although no grandmother of my acquaintance would have sat unperturbed through that squall and indifferent to her wet clothing afterward. She didn't appear to mind it in the least, and now that it was over, fished a paper of tobacco and a strip of pandanus leaf out of the bundle on which she was sitting. She rolled a pinch of tobacco in the leaf, twisting it into a tight corkscrew, and lit it at the first attempt. Then she began talking in a deep, resonant voice, and by a simplicity and an extraordinary lucidity of gesture, conveyed the greater part of her meaning even to an alien like myself. It was not, alas, a typical accomplishment. I have not since found others similarly gifted. She was Crichton's landlady, the owner of Tanau, Pupri, she called him, because of his fair hair. I couldn't make out what she was driving at for a little while. I understood at last that she wanted to know about his family, where his father was, and his mother. I suppose she thought I must know him, being a white man. They have queer ideas of the size of our world. He was young. He must have people somewhere. She, too, couldn't understand his wanting to go to Tanau, and I gathered from her perplexity that he hadn't confided his purposes to her to any extent. I couldn't enlighten her, of course, and at length, realizing this, she wrapped herself in her mat to preserve the damp warmth of her body, and dozed off to sleep. I went below for a blanket and some dry clothing, for the night air was uncomfortably cool after the rain. The cabin floor was strewn with sleeping forms. Three children were curled up in a corner like puppies in a box of sawdust. Little brown babies lay snugly bedded on bundles of clothing, the mothers themselves sleeping in the careless, trustful attitudes of children. The light from a swinging lamp threw leaping shadows on the walls, flowed smoothly over brown arms and legs, was caught in faint gleams in masses of loose black hair. And, to complete the picture and make it wholly true to fact, cockroaches of the enormous winged variety ran with incredible speed over the oilcloth of the cabin table, or made sudden flying sallies out of dark corners to the food lockers and back again. On deck, no one was awake except Maui at the wheel. There was very little unoccupied space, but I found a strip against the engine room ventilator, where I could stretch out at full length. By that time, the moon was up, and it was almost as light as day. I was not at all sleepy, and my thoughts went forward to the Paumotus, the cloud of islands. We ought to be making our first landfall within 36 hours. I didn't go beyond that in anticipation, although in the mind's eye I had seen them for months, first one island and then another. I had pictured them at dawn, rising out of the sea against a far horizon, or at night, under the wan light of stars, lonely beyond one's happiest dreams of isolation, unspoiled, unchanged, because of their very remoteness. Well, I was soon to know whether or not they fulfilled my hopeful expectations. Someone came aft, walking along the rail in his bare feet. It was Oro, the cabin boy, who was taken with an enviable kind of madness at the full of the moon. He looked carefully around to make sure that everyone was asleep, then stood clasping and unclasping his hands in ecstasy, carrying on a one-sided conversation in a confidential undertone. Now and then he would smile and straightway become serious again, gazing with rapt, listening attention at the world of pure light, nodding his head at intervals in vigorous confirmation of some occult confidence. At length, his figure receded, blurred, took on the quality of the moonlight, and I saw him no more. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of Faery Lands of the South Seas. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Mike Vendetti. Chapter 2. In the Cloud of Islands. Raoul, the old Paumotan woman, and the owner of Tanau, was the last of her family. There were relatives by marriage, but none of them would consent to live on so poor an atoll, and the original population, never large, had diminished through death and migration, until at last she was left alone, living in her memories of other days, awed by the companionship of spirits present to her in strange and terrible shapes. At last she felt that she could endure it no longer. But it was many months before the smoke of one of her signal fires was seen by a passing schooner. She returned with it to Tahiti, and if she had been lonely before, she was tenfold lonelier there, so far from the graves of her husband and children. It was at this time that Crichton met her. He had been living at Tahiti for more than a year, on the lookout for just such an opportunity as Rahu offered him. Although only 28, he was in the 10th year of his wanderings, and had almost despaired of finding the place he had so long dreamed of and searched for. During that period he had been moving slowly eastward through Borneo, New Guinea, the Solomons, the New Hebrides, the Tongas, the Cook group. In some of these islands the climate was too powerful an enemy for a white man to contend with. In others there was no land available, or they lacked the solitude he wanted. This latter embarrassment was the one he had met at Tahiti. The fact is an illuminating commentary on his character. Most men would find exceptional opportunities for seclusion there, not on the seaboard, but in the mountains, in the valleys winding deeply among them, where no one goes from year's end to year's end. Even those leading out to the sea are but little frequented in their upward reaches. But Crichton was very exacting in his requirements in this respect. He was one of those men who make few or no friends, one of those lonely spirits, without the ties or the kindly human associations which make life pleasant to most of us. They wander the thinly peopled places of the earth, interested in a large way at what they see from afar or faintly hear, but looking on with quiet eyes, taking no part, being blessed or cursed by nature with a love of silence, of the unchanging peace of great solitudes. One reads of them now and then in fiction, and if they live in fiction, it is because of men like Crichton. They're prototypes in reality, seen for a moment as they slip apprehensively across some bypath leading from the outside world. He had a little place at Tahiti, a walk of 2 hours and a quarter, he said, from the government offices in the port. He had to go there sometimes to attend to the usual formalities, and I have no doubt that he knew within 10 seconds the length of the journey, which would be a very distasteful one to him. I can imagine his uneasiness at what he saw and heard on those infrequent visits. And after the war, renewal of activity, talk of trade, development, progress, would startle him into a waiting, listening attitude. Returning home, maps and charts would be got out, and plans made against the day when it would be necessary for him to move on. He told me of his accidental meeting with Rahu, as he called the old Pomonian woman. It came only a few days after the arrival from San Francisco of one of the monthly steamers. A crowd of tourists, stopover passengers of a day, had somehow discovered the dim trail leading to his house. They were much pleased with it, he said, adding with restraint, they took a good many pictures. I was rather annoyed at this, although, of course, I said nothing. No doubt they made the usual remarks, charming, so quaint, etc. It was the last straw for Crichton. So he made another visit to the government offices, where he had his passport visied. He meant to go to Marquita, a high phosphate island, which stands like a gateway at the northwestern approach to the low archipelago. The phosphate would be worked out in time, and the place abandoned, as other islands of that nature had been, to the seabirds. But on that same evening, while he was having dinner at a Chinaman's shop, he overheard Rahu trying to persuade some of her relatives to return with her to Tanao. He knew of the island. He is one of the few men who would know of it. He had often looked at it on his charts, being attracted by its isolated position. The very place for him. And the old woman, he said, When she learned that he wanted to go there, that he wanted to stay always, all his life, gripped his hand in both of hers and held them, crying softly without saying anything more. The relatives made some objections to the arrangement at first, but the island being remote, poverty-stricken, haunted, they were soon persuaded to consent to a 10 years lease with the option of renewal. Crichton promised, of course, to take care of Rao as long as she lived, and at her death to bury her decently beside her husband. He proceeded at once with his altered plans. There were government regulations to be complied with, and these had taken some time. On the day when he was at last free to start, he learned that the Calabas Winship was about to sail on a 3 months voyage in the Low Archipelago. He had no time to ask for passage beforehand. He had to chance the possibility of getting it at the last moment. It is not to be supposed that either the manager of the Interland Trading Company or the supercargo of the Winship would have consented to carry him to such an out-of-the-way destination had they known his reason for wanting to be set down there. It amuses me now to think of those two hard-headed traders, men without a trace of sentiment, going 150 miles off their course merely to carry the least gregarious of wanderers on the last leg of his long journey to an ideal solitude. It was their curiosity which gained him this end. They believed he had some secret purpose, some reason of purely material self-interest in view. They had both seen Tanao from a distance and knew that it had never been worth visiting either for pearl shell or cobra. It is hard to understand what miracle they believed might have taken place in the meantime. During the voyage, I often heard them talking about the atoll, about Crichton, wondering, conjecturing, and always miles off the track. It was plain that he was a good deal disturbed by their hints and furtive questionings. He seemed to be afraid that mere talk about Tanao on the part of an outsider might sully the purity of its loneliness. He may have been a little selfish in his attitude, but if that is a fault in a man of his temperament, it is one easily forgiven. And what could he have said to those traders? It was much better to keep silent and let them believe what they liked. It must not be thought that Crichton poured out his confidence to me like a schoolgirl. On the contrary, he had a very likable reserve, although a good half of it, I should say, was shyness. Then, too, he had almost forgotten how to talk except in the native dialects of several groups of widely scattered islands. In English, he had a tendency to prolong his vowels and to omit consonants, which gave his speech a peculiar exotic sound. He made no advances for some time, neither did I. For more than 3 weeks we lived together on shipboard, went ashore together at islands where we had put in for a copra, and all that while we did not exchange above 200 words in conversation. There was so little talk that I can remember the whole of it, almost word for word. Once while we were walking on the outer beach at Rikaraga, an atoll of 35 inhabitants, he said to me, "I wish I had come out here years ago. They appeal to the imagination, don't you think? All these islands." His volubility startled me. It was a shock to the senses, like the crash of a coconut on a tin roof heard in the profound stillness of an island night. There was my opportunity to throw off reserve, and I lost it through my surprise. I merely said, "Yes, very much." An hour later, we saw the captain, no larger than a penny doll, at the end of a long vista of empty beach, beckoning us to come back. We went aboard without having spoken again. It was an odd sort of relationship for two white men thrown into close contact on a small trading schooner in the loneliest ocean in the world, as Nordhoff put it. We were no more companionable in an ordinary sense than a pair of hermit crabs. But the need for talking drops away from men under such circumstances, and neither of us found the long silences embarrassing. The spell of the islands was upon us both. I can imagine Crichton speaking of their appeal to the imagination when we were in the midst of them. For our presence there seemed an illusion, a dream more radiant than any reality could be. In fact, my only hold upon reality during that voyage was the Caleb S. Winship, and sometimes even that substantial old vessel suffered sea changes, was metamorphosed in a moment, and it was hard to believe that she was a boat built by man's hands. Often, as she lay at anchor in a lagoon of dreamlike beauty, I paddled out from shore in a small canoe, and, making fast under her stern, spent an afternoon watching the upward play of the reflections from the water and the blue shadows underneath rippling out and vanishing in the light like flames of fire. For me, her homely, rugged New England name was a pleasant link with the past. I liked to read the print of it. The word Boston, her old home port, was still faintly legible through a coat of white paint. It brought to mind old memories and the faces of old friends, hard to visualize in these surroundings without such practical help. Far below lay the floor of the lagoon, where all the rainbows of the world have authentic end. The water was so clear, and the sunlight streamed through it with so little loss in brightness, that one seemed to be suspended in midair above the forests of branching coral. The deep, cool valleys and the wide, sandy plains of that strange continent. Crichton, I believe, was beyond the desire to keep in touch with the world he had left so many years before. His experiences there may have been bitter ones. At any rate, he never spoke of them, and I doubt if he thought of them often. People had little interest for him, not even those of the atolls which we visited. When on shore, I usually found him on the outer beaches, away from the villages, which lie along the lagoon. In most of the atolls, the distance from beach to beach is only a few hundred yards, but the ocean side is unfrequented and solitary. On calm days, when the tide begins to ebb, the silence there is unearthly. The wide shore, hot and glaring in the sun, stretches away as far as the eye can reach, empty of life except for thousands of small hermit crabs moving into the shade of the palms. They snap into their shells at your approach and make fast the door as their houses fall, with a sound like tinkling hailstones among heaps of broken coral. We waded along the shallows at low tide, when the wind was on shore and a heavy surf breaking over the outer edge of the reef. We sat as close to it as we could, watching the seas gathering far out, rising in sheer walls, fringed with wind-whipped spray, which seemed higher than the island itself as they approached. It was a fascinating sight, the reef hidden in many places in a perpetual smoke of sunlight-filtered mist, through which the oncoming breakers could be seen dimly as they swept forward, curled, and fell. But one could not avoid a feeling of uneasiness, of insecurity, thinking of what had happened in those islands, most of them only a meter or two above sea level in the hurricanes of the past, and of what would happen again at the coming of the next great storm. We made landfalls at dawn, in mid-afternoon, late at night, saw the islands in aspects of beauty exceeding one's strangest imaginings. We penetrated further and further into the 1,000-mile area of atoll-dotted auction, discharging our cargo of lumber and corrugated iron, rice and flour, and canned goods, taking on copra, carrying native passengers from one place to another. Sometimes we were out of sight of land for several days, beating into headwinds under a slowly moving pageantry of clouds which alone gave assurance of the rotundity of the earth. When the last land appeared, it seemed inaccessibly remote at the summit of a long slope of water, which we would never be able to climb. Sometimes, for as long a period, we skirted the shore line of a single atoll, the water deepening and shoaling under our keel in splotches of vague or vivid coloring. From a vantage point in the rigging, one could see a segment of a vast circle of islands strung at haphazard on a thread of reef, which showed a thin, clear line of changing red and white under the incessant battering of the surf. Several times, upon going ashore, we found the villages deserted, the inhabitants having gone to distant parts of the atoll for the copra-making season. In one village, we came upon an old man, too feeble to go with the others, apparently sitting in the shade, playing a phonograph. He had but three records: Away to the Forest, The Dance of the Nymphs, Schottische, and Just a Song at Twilight. The discs were as old as the instrument itself, no doubt, and the needles so badly worn that one could barely hear the music above the rasping of the mechanism. There was a groove on the vocal record where the needle caught, and the singer, a woman with a high, quivery voice, repeated the same phrase, "When the lights are low," over and over again. I can still hear it, even at this distance of time and place, and recall vividly to mind the silent houses, the wide, vacant street, bright with fugitive sunshine, the lagoon at the end of it, mottled with the shadows of clouds. The sense of our remoteness grew upon me as the weeks and months passed. Once rounding a point of land, we came upon two schooners lying inside the reef of a small atoll. One of them had left Papeete only a short while before. Her skipper gave us a bundle of old newspapers. Glancing through them that evening, I heard, as in a dream, the far-off clamor of the outside world, the shrieking of whistles, the roar of trains, the strident warnings of motors. But there was no reality, no allurement in the sound. I saw men carrying trivial bundles with an air of immense effort, of grotesque self-importance, scurrying in breathless haste on useless errands, gorging food without relish, sleeping without refreshment, taking their leisure without enjoyment, living without the knowledge of content, dying without ever having lived. The pictures which came to mind as I read were distorted, untrue, no doubt, for by the time I was almost as much attracted by the lonely life of the islands as my friend Christian. My odd feeling of restlessness was gone. In its place had come a certitude of happiness, a sense of well-being, for which I can find no parallel this side of boyhood. It was largely the result of living among people who are as permanently happy, I believe, as it is possible for humankind to be. And the more remote the island, the more slender the thread of communication with civilization as we know it, the happier they were. It was not in my imagination that I found this true, or that I had determined beforehand to see only so much of their life as might be agreeable and pleasant to me. On the contrary, if I had any bias at first, it was on the other side. Disillusionment is a sad experience, and I had no desire to lay myself open to it. Therefore, I listened willingly to the less favorable stories of native character which the traders and others who knew them had to tell, but summed up dispassionately later in the light of my own observations. It seemed to me that the faults of character of which they were accused were more like the natural shortcomings of children. In many respects, the Pomotans, like other divisions of the Polynesian family, are children who have never grown up, and one can't blame them for a lack of the artificial virtues which come only with maturity. They are without guile. They have little of the shrewdness or craftiness of some primitive peoples. At least so it appeared to me. Making as careful a judgment of them as I could, I have often noticed how, like children, they are in their amazing trustfulness, their impulsive generosity, and in the intensity and briefness of their emotions. The more I saw of their life, the more desirable it seemed that they might continue to escape any serious encroachments of European or American civilization. They have no doctors, because illness is almost unknown in their islands. Crime, insanity, feeble-mindedness, evils, all too common with us, are of such rare occurrence that one may say they do not exist. It may be said, too, without overstatement, that their community life very nearly approaches perfection. Every atoll is a little world to itself, with a population varying from 25 to perhaps 300 inhabitants. The chief, who is chosen informally by the men, serves for a period of 4 years under the sanction of the French government. He has very little to do with the exercise of his authority, for the people govern themselves, are law-abiding without law. When I first learned that there are no schools throughout the islands, I thought the French guilty of criminal neglect. But later I reversed this opinion. After all, why should they have schools? No education of ours could make them more generous, more kindly disposed to one another, more hospitable and courteous toward strangers, happier than they are now. Certainly, it could not make them less selfish, covetous, rapacious, for most of them are as innocent of those vices as their own children. In a few of the richer, more accessible islands, they are slowly changing in these respects, owing to the example set them by men of our own race. In another 50 years, perhaps they may have learned to believe that material wealth is the only thing worth striving for. Then will come pride in their possessions, envy of those who have greater, contempt and suspicion for those who have less, and so an end to their happiness. I had never before seen children growing up in a state of nature, and I made full use of the rare opportunity. I spent most of my time with them, played on shore with them, went fishing and swimming with them, and found in the experience something better than a renewal of boyhood, because of a keener sense of beauty, a more conscious, mature appreciation of the happiness one has in the simplest kinds of pleasures. Sometimes we started in our excursions at dawn. Sometimes we made them by moonlight. I became a collector of shells in order to give some purpose to our expeditions along the reef. I couldn't have chosen a better interest, for they knew all about shells, where and when to find the best ones, and they could indulge their love of giving to a limitless extent. In the afternoons, we went swimming in the lagoon. There I saw them at their best and happiest, in an element as necessary and familiar to them as it is to their parents. It is always a pleasure to watch children at play in the water, but those Paumotan youngsters, with their natural grace at swimming and diving, put one under an enchantment. Many of the boys had water glasses and small spears of their own and went far from shore catching fish. They lay face down on the surface of the water, swimming easily, with a great economy of motion, turning their heads now and then for a breath of air. And when they saw their prey, they dived under it as skillfully as their fathers do and with nearly as much success. Seen against the bright floor of the lagoon, with swarms of brilliantly colored fish scattering before them, they seemed doubtfully human, the children of some forsaken merman, rather than creatures who have need of air to breathe and solid earth to stand on. If education is the suitable preparation for life, the children of the atolls have it at its best and happiest without knowing that it is an education. They are skillful in the pursuits and learned in the interests which touch their lives, and one can wish them no better fortune than that they may remain in ignorance of those which do not. Their parents, as I have said, are but children of mature stature, with the same gift of frank, generous laughter, the same delight in the new and strange. Very little is required to amuse them. I had a mandolin which I used to take ashore with me at various atolls after I had become convinced that their enjoyment of my music was not feigned. At first I was suspicious, for I had no illusions about my virtuosity, and even when I thought of it in the most flattering way, their pleasure seemed out of all proportion to the quality of the performance. But there was no doubting the genuineness of it. The whole village would assemble to hear me play. I had a limited repertoire, but that seemed to matter very little. They liked to hear the same tunes played over and over again. I learned some of the old missionary hymns which they knew. From Greenland's icy mountains, oh, happy day, we're marching to Zion, and others. It was strange to find those songs belonging, fortunately, to a bygone period in English and American life, living still in that remote part of the world, not because of anything universal in their appeal, but merely because they had been carried there years ago by representatives of the missionary societies. Many eccentric changes had been made in both the rhythm and the melody, greatly to the improvement of both, but no amount of changing could make them other than what they are, the uncouth expression of a narrow and ugly kind of religious sentiment. I don't think the Paumotians care much for them either. They always seem glad to turn from them to their own songs, which have nothing either of modern or old-time missionary feeling. A woman used to begin the singing in a high-pitched, nasal, or throaty voice, which she modulated in an extraordinary way. Immediately, other women joined in, then several men, whose voices were of tenor quality, followed by other men in basses and baritones, chanting in two or three tones which, for rhythm and tone quality, were like the beating of kettle drums. The weird blending of harmonies was unlike anything I had ever heard before. There is nothing in our music which even remotely resembles theirs, so that it is impossible to describe the effect of the full chorus. Some of the songs make a strong appeal to savage instincts. The less resolute of the early missionaries hearing them must have thrown up their hands in despair at the thought of the long, difficult task of conversion awaiting them. But if there were any irresolute missionaries, they were evidently overruled by their sterner brothers and sisters. On nearly every island there is now a church, either Protestant or Catholic. In the Protestant ones, the native population practiced the only true faith, largely to the accompaniment of this old barbaric music. Those unsightly little structures rocked to the sound of exultant choruses which ought never to be sung within doors. The Paumotans themselves know best the natural setting of their songs. The lagoon beach with a great fire of coconut husk blazing in the center of a group of singers. I like to hear them from a distance, where I could get their full effect. To look on from the schooner lying a few hundred yards offshore, all the inhabitants of the village would be gathered within the circle of the firelight, which brought their figures and the white, straight stems of the coconut palms into clear relief against a background of deep shadow. The singing continued far into the night, so that I often fell asleep while listening, and heard the music dying away, mingling at last with the interminable booming of the surf. By degrees we worked slowly through the heart of the archipelago, pursuing a general southeasterly course, the islands becoming more and more scattered, until we had before us an expanse of ocean, almost unbroken, to the coast of South America. But Tanao lay at the edge of it, and at length, on a lowering April day, we set out on the last leg of our outward journey. The Caleb S. Winship lay very low in the water. By that time she had a full cargo of copra, 100 tons in the hold, and 12 stacked on deck. A portion of the deck cargo was lost that same afternoon during a gale of wind and rain, which burst upon us with fury and followed us with a seeming malignancy of attempt. We ran before it, far out of our course, for 3 hours. To me the weight of air was something incredible, an unusually vigorous flourish of the departing hurricane season. Water spouted out of the scuppers in a continuous stream, and loose articles were swept clear of the ship, disappearing at once in a cloud of blinding rain. There was a fearful racket in the cabin of rolling biscuit tins and smashing crockery. Then an 800-pound safe broke loose, and it started to imitate Victor Hugo's cannon. Luckily, it hadn't much scope and no smooth runway, so that it was soon brought to a halt by Rayu, the old Paumotu woman, who was the only one below at the time. She made an effective blockade of copra sacks and bedding, dodging the plunging monster with an agility surprising in a woman of 60. But what I remember best was Tane, a monkey belonging to one of the sailors, skidding along the cabin deck until he was blown against the engine room whistle, which rose just clear of the forward end of it. He wrapped his arms and legs around it in his terror, opening the valve in some way, and the shrill blast rose high above the mighty roar of wind, like the voice of a man lifted with awe-inspiring impudence in defiance of the mindless anger of nature. The storm blew itself out towards sundown, and the night fell clear, a night for stars to make one wary of thought. But the moon rose about 9, softening the pitiless distances, throwing a veil of mild light across the black voids in the Milky Way, seen so clearly in those latitudes. The schooner was riding a heavy swell, and burdened as she was, rose clumsily to it, sticking her nose into the slope of every sea. Rau was at her accustomed place against the cabin ventilator, unmindful of the showers of spray, maintaining her position on the sliding deck with the skill of 3 months' practice. The thought that I must soon bid her goodbye saddened me, for I knew there was small chance that I should ever meet her again. I envied Christian his opportunity for friendship with that noble old woman, so proud of her race, so true to her own beliefs, to her own way of living. Her type is none too common among Polynesians in these days. One gets all too frequently an impression of a consciousness of inferiority on their part, a sense of shame because of their simple way of living as compared with ours. Raoul was not guilty of it. She never could be, I think, under any circumstances. I learned afterwards of an attempt which had been made to convert her to Christianity during their stay at Tahiti. Evidently, she had not been at all convinced by the priest's arguments, and when he made some slighting remark about the ghosts and spirits which were so real to her, she refused to listen any longer. Frightened though she was of spirits, she was not willing that they should be ridiculed. We sighted her atoll at dawn, such a dawn as one rarely sees outside the tropics. The sky was overcast at a great height, with a film of luminous mist, through which the sun shone wanly, throwing a sheen like a dust of gold on the sea. Masses of slate-colored cloud billowed out from the high canopy, overhanging a black fringe of land which lay just below the line of the horizon. The atoll was elliptical in shape, about 8 miles long by 5 broad. There were 7 widely separated islands on the circle of reef and 1 small Motu in the lagoon. We came into the wind about a 1/2 mile offshore and put off in the whaleboat. The sea was still running fairly high, and the roar of the surf came across the water with a sound as soothing as the fall of spring rain, but it increased in volume as we drew in until the ears were stunned by the crash of tremendous combers which toppled and fell sheer over the ledge of the reef. It was by far the most dangerous-looking landing-place we had seen on the journey. There was no break in the reef, only a few narrow indentations where the surf spouted up in clouds of spray. Between the breaking of one sea and the gathering of the next, the water poured back over a jagged wall of rock, bared for an instant to an appalling depth. Only a native crew could have managed that landing. We rowed comber after comber, the sailors backing on their oars, awaiting the word of the boat steerer, who stood with his feet braced on the gunwales, his head turned over his shoulder, watching the following seas. All at once he began shouting at the top of his voice. I looked back in time to see a wall of water on the point of breaking rising high above us. It fell just after it passed under us, and we were carried forward across the edge of the reef, through the inner shallows to the beach. The two traders started off at once on a tour of inspection, and we saw nothing more of them until late in the evening. Meanwhile, I went with Raoul and Crichton across the island to the lagoon beach where her house was. As in most of the atolls, the ground was nearly free from undergrowth, the soil affording nourishment only to the trees and a few hardy shrubs. Coconuts and dead fronds were scattered everywhere. A few half-wild pigs, feeding on the shoots of sprouted nuts, gazed up with an odd air of incredulity, of amazement, as we approached, then galloped off at top speed and disappeared far in the distance. Raoul stopped when we were about halfway across and held up her hand for silence. A bird was singing somewhere, a melodious, varied song like that of the hermit thrush. I had heard it before and had once seen the bird, a shy, solitary little thing, one of the few species of land birds found on the atolls. While we were standing there, listening to the faint music, Crichton took me by the arm. He said nothing and in a moment withdrew his hand. I was deeply moved by that manifestation of friendliness, an unusual one for him to make. He had some unaccountable defect in his character which kept him aloof from any relationship approaching real intimacy. I believe he was constantly aware of it, and that he had made many futile attempts to overcome it. It may have been that which first set him on his wanderings, now happily at an end. It was plain to me the moment we set foot on shore that he would have to seek no further for asylum. Tanao is one of the undoubted ends of the earth. No one would ever disturb him there. He himself was not so sure of this. Once, I remember, when we were looking at the place on the chart, She spoke of the island of Pitcairn, the old-time refuge of the Bounty mutineers. Before the opening of the Panama Canal, it has been as far removed from contact with the outside world as an island could be. Now it lies not far off the route through the canal to New Zealand, and is visited from time to time by the crews of tramp steamers and schooners. Tanao, however, is much further to the north, and there is very slight possibility that its empty horizons will ever be stained by a smudge of smoke. As for an actual visit, one glance at the reef through the binoculars would convince any skipper of the folly of the attempt. Even our own crew of natives, skilled at such hazardous work, came to grief in their second passage over it. They had gone out to the schooner for supplies. Crichton had ordered a few sacks of flour, some canned goods, and kerosene oil. In coming back, the boat had been swept broadside against a ledge of rock. It stuck there, just at the edge of the reef, and the sailors jumped out with the line before the next wave came, capsizing the boat and carrying it inshore, bottom up. All the supplies were swept into deep water by the backwash and lost. There had been a similar accident at the other atoll, flour and rice brought so many thousands of miles having been spoiled within a few yards of their destination. I remember the natives plunging into the water at great risk to themselves to save a few sacks of soggy paste in the hope that a little of the flour in the center might still be dry, and a Chinese storekeeper to whom it was consigned standing on the shore wringing his hands in dumb grief. It was the first time I had ever seen a Chinaman make any display of emotion, and the sight brought home to me a conception of the tragic nature of such accidents to the inhabitants of those distant islands. Crichton took his loss calmly, concealing whatever disappointment he may have felt. Raoul was not at all concerned about it, and while we were making an examination of the house, went out on the lagoon in a canoe and caught more than enough fish for supper. Then we found that all of our matches had been spoiled by seawater, so we could make no fire. Judging by the way Crichton brightened up at his discovery, one would have thought the loss a piece of luck. He set to work at once to make an apparatus for kindling fire. But before it was finished, Raoul had the fish cleaned and spread out on a coverlet of green leaves. We ate them raw, dipping them first into a sauce of coconut milk, and for dessert had a salad made of the heart of a tree. I don't remember ever having eaten with heartier appetite, but at the same time, I couldn't imagine myself enjoying an unrelieved diet of coconuts and fish for a period of 10 years. Not for so long as a year, in fact. Crichton, however, was used to it, and Raoul had never known any other except during her 3 months' stay at Tahiti, where she had eaten strange hot food, which had not agreed with her at all, she said. Dusk came on as we sat over our meal. Raoul sat with her hands on her knees, leaning back against a tree, talking to Crichton. I understood nothing of what she was saying, but it was a pleasure merely to listen to the music of her voice. It was a little below the usual register of women's voices, strong and clear, but softer even than those of the Tahitians, and so flexible that I could follow every change in mood. She was telling Crichton of the topoku of her atoll, which she dreaded most, although she knew that it was the spirit of one of her own sons. It appeared in the form of a dog, with legs as long and thick as the stem of a full-grown coconut tree, and a body proportionally huge. It could have picked up her house as an ordinary dog would a basket. Once it had stepped lightly over it without offering to harm her in any way. Her last son had been drowned while fishing by moonlight on the reef outside the next island, which lay about 2 miles distant across the eastern end of the lagoon. She had seen the dog 3 times since his death, and always at the same phase of the moon. Twice she had come upon it lying at full length on the lagoon beach, its enormous head resting on its paws. She was so badly frightened, she said, that she fell to the ground, incapable of further movement. Sick at heart, too, at the thought that the spirit of the bravest and strongest of all her sons must appear to her in that shape. It was clear that she was recognized, for each time the dog began beating its tail on the ground as soon as it saw her. Then it got up, yawned and stretched, took a long drink of salt water, and started at a lope up the beach. She could see it very plainly in the bright moonlight. Soon it broke into a run, going faster and faster, gathering tremendous speed by the time it reached the other end of the island. From there it made a flying spring, and she last saw it as it passed high in air across the face of the moon, its head outstretched, its legs doubled close under its body. She believed that it crossed the 2-mile gap of water which separated the islands in one gigantic leap. That is the whole of the story as Crichton translated it for me, although there must have been other details. Varro gave her account of it at great length. Her earnestness of manner was very convincing and left no doubt in my mind of the realness to her of the apparition. As for myself, if I could have seen ghosts anywhere, it would have been at Tanao. Late that night, walking alone on the lagoon beach, I found that I was keeping an uneasy watch behind me. The distant thunder of the surf sounded at times like a wild galloping on the hard sand, and the gentle slapping of little waves nearby like the leaping tongue of the ghostly dog having its fill of seawater. We left Tanao with a fair wind the following afternoon, having been delayed in getting away because of the damaged whaleboat, which had to be repaired on shore. Tino, the supercargo, insisted on pushing off at once, the moment the work was finished. Crichton and Raoul were on the other beach at the time, so that I had no opportunity to say goodbye. But as we were getting under way, I saw him emerge from the deep shadow and stand for a moment, his hand shading his eyes, looking out toward the schooner. I waved, but evidently he didn't see me, for there was no response. Then he turned, walked slowly up the beach, and disappeared among the trees. For 3 hours I watched the atoll dwindling and blurring until at sunset it was lost to view under the rim of the southern horizon. Looking back across that space of empty ocean, I imagined that I could still see it dropping further and further away, down the reverse slope of a smooth curve of water, as though it were vanishing for all time beyond the knowledge and concern of men. My first packet of letters from Nordhoff was brought by the skipper of the schooner Alouette. He had been carrying it about for many weeks, and had it in the first place from the supercargo of another vessel, met at Ratu, in the Astral Group. The envelope, tattered and weather-stained, spoke of its long journey in search of me. Before separating at Papeete, we had arranged for a rendezvous. But at that time we still possessed American ideas of punctuality and well-ordered travel. Now we knew something of the casual movements of trading schooners, and have learned to regard the timely arrival of a letter as an event touching on the miraculous, the keeping of a rendezvous a possibility too remote for consideration. One hears curious tales in this part of the world of the outcome of such temporary leave-taking as ours was meant to be. Husbands seeking their wives, and wives their husbands. Families scattered among these fragments of land, and striving for many months to reunite. I witnessed not long ago the sequel of one of these unsuccessful quests. A native from a distant group of islands set out for one of the atolls of the Low Archipelago, the home of his sweetheart. Arrangements for the marriage had been made long before, but letters had gone astray, and upon his arrival, the young man found that the family of his prospective father-in-law had gone to another atoll for the diving season. With no means of following, he submitted to the inevitable and married another girl. Months later, the woman of his first choice returned with her second choice of a husband, and the former lovers met, for the young man had not yet been able to return to his own island. Neither made any question of the other's decision. Life is too short. And from the native point of view, it is foolish to spend it in wanderings which, at the least, may never fulfill her purpose. Nevertheless, I shall make a search for Nordhoff, a leisurely search, with some expectation of finding him. Our islands, like those of Mr. Conrad's, enchanted, heist, are bounded by a circle, 2,000 or more miles across, and it is likely that neither of us will ever succeed in breaking through to the outside world if, indeed, there is an outside world. I am beginning to doubt this, for the enchantment is at work. As for Nordhoff, his letters which follow may speak for themselves. End of chapter 2. of Faery Lands of the South Seas. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Mike Vendetti. Chapter 3. Marooned on Matora. The sun was low when the Fiat steamed out through the pass and headed for the Cook group, 600 miles west and south. Dark clouds hung over Raeta, Regi, Etia of Moray tradition, the land of the bright heavens. But the level sunlight still illuminated the hillsides of Tahaha, the lovely sister island, protected by the same great oval reef. Far off to the north, the peak of Bora Bora towered abruptly from the sea. It was not yet the season of the trades, and the northeast breeze which followed us brought a sweltering heat, intolerable anywhere but on deck. Worthington was sitting beside me, a lean man, darkly tanned, with very bright blue eyes. His feet were bare. He wore a singlet, trousers of white drill, and a Manihiki hat, beautifully plaited of bleached pandama sleeve, a hat not to be bought with money. The dinner gong sounded. "I'm not going down," he remarked. "Too hot below. I had something to eat in Utora. How about you?" I shook my head. It needed more than a normal appetite to drive me to the dining salon. Banks of squall cloud, shading from gray to an unwholesome violet, were gathering along the horizon, and the air was so heavy that one inhaled it with an effort. "This is the worst month of the hurricane season," Worthington went on. "It was just such an evening as this last year that the waterspout nearly got us the night we sighted Mataora. I was 5 months up there, you know, marooned, when Johnson lost the old Hatutu. I was pretty well done up last year when I heard that the Hatutu was in Avura. I decided to take a vacation and go for a 6 weeks cruise with Johnson. Ordinarily, he would have laid up in Papeete until after the equinox, but the company had sent for him to make a special trip to Byron. He had a wretched passage north, a succession of squalls and broiling calms. The schooner was in bad shape anyway, rotten sails, rigging falling to pieces, and 6 inches of grass on her bottom. On a hot day, she had a bouquet all her own. The sun distilled from her a blend of cockroaches and mildewed copra that didn't smell like a rose garden. On the 13th day, the skipper told me we were 200 miles from Peñon, and so close to Matora that we might sight the palm tops. I'd heard a lot about the place. It has an English name on the chart. How isolated it was, what a pleasant crowd the natives were, and how it was the best place in the Pacific to see old-fashioned island life. We had been working to windward against a light northerly breeze, but the wind began to drop at noon, and by 3 o'clock it was glassy calm. There was a wicked-looking mass of clouds moving toward us from the west, but the glass was high, and Johnson said we were in for nothing worse than a squall. As the clouds drew near, I could see that they had a sort of purplish black heart, broad at the top, pointed at the bottom, and dropping gradually toward the water. There was something queer about it. The mate was pointing, and Johnson's Kanakas were all standing up. Suddenly I heard a rushing sound like a heavy squall passing through the bush. The point of the funnel had touched the sea 300 or 400 yards away from us, a waterspout. There wasn't a breath of air, and the Hatutu had no engine. It was moving straight for us, so slowly that I could watch every detail of its formation. The boys slid our boat overboard. The mate sang out something about all hands being ready to leave the schooner. I've heard of waterspouts ever since I was a youngster, but I never expected to see one as close as we did that day. As the point of cloud dropped toward the sea, it was ragged and ill-defined, but when it touched the water and the noise began, I saw its shape change and its outlines grow hard. It was now a thin column 4 or 5 feet in diameter, raising a couple of hundred feet before it swelled in the form of a flat cone to join the clouds above. Curiously enough, it was not perpendicular, but had a decided sagging curve. Nearer and nearer it came until I could make out the great swirling hole at its base and see the vitreous look of this column of solid water revolving at amazing speed. It hadn't the misty edges of a waterfall. The outside was sharply defined as the walls of a tumbler. I wondered what would happen when it struck the Hatutu. The mate was shouting again, but just then the skipper pushed a rifle into my hands. "Damned if I leave the old hooker," he swore. "Shoot into the thing. Maybe we can break it up." And believe me or not, we did break it up. It didn't come down with a crash, as one might have expected. When we had pumped about 20 shots into it, it was not more than 50 yards away. It began to dwindle. The column of water became smaller and drew itself out to nothing. The rushing noise ceased. The hole in the sea disappeared in a lazy eddy. The dark funnel rose and blended with the clouds above. A fine southeast breeze sprang up as the clouds disappeared, and we were reaching away for Peron when a boy up forward gave a shout and pointed to the northwest. Sure enough, there was a faint line on the horizon, the palms of Mataora. A sudden idea came to me. I was fed up with the schooner. Why not ask to be put ashore and picked up on the Hatutu's return from Peron? She would be back in a fortnight, and it was only a few miles out of her way to drop me and pick me up. Johnson is a good fellow. His answer to my proposition was to change his course at once and slack away for the land 12 miles to leeward. "You'll have a great time," he said. "I wish I were going with you. Old Terry will put you up. I'll give you a word to him. Take along 2 or 3 bags of flour and a few presents for the women." At 5 o'clock, we were off the principal village with canoes all about us and more coming out through the surf. The men were a fine, brawny lot, joking with the crew and eager for news and small trade. I lowered my box, some flour, tobacco, and a few bolts of calico into the largest canoe and said goodbye to Johnson. It was nearly a year before I saw him again. As you know, he lost a Hatutu on Flying Venus Shoal. They made Penrhyn in the boat and got a passage to Tahiti 2 months later. Everyone knew I was on Mataora, but it was 5 months before a schooner could come and take me off. There is no pass into the lagoon. As we drew near the shore, I saw that the easy, deceptive swell reared up to form an ugly surf ahead of us. At one point, where a crowd of people was gathered, there was a large, irregular fissure in the coral, broad and deep enough to admit the passage of a small boat, and filled with rushing water each time a breaker crashed on the reef. My two paddlers stopped opposite this fissure, and just outside the surf, watching over their shoulders for the right wave. They let 4 or 5 good-sized ones pass, backing water gently with their paddles. But at last a proper one came, rearing and tossing its crest till I thought it would break before it reached us. My men dug their paddles into the water, shouting exultantly as they darted forward. The shouts were echoed on shore. By Jove, it was a thriller! Tilting just on the break of the wave, we flew in between jagged walls of coral up the fissure, around a turn, and before the water began to rush back, a dozen men and women had plunged in waist-deep to seize the canoe. Mataora is made up of a chain of low islands, all densely covered with coconut palms, strung together in rough oval to enclose a lagoon 5 miles by 3. Though there is no pass, the surf at high tide breaches over the gaps between the islands. The largest island is only 1.5 miles long, and none of them are more than 1/2 mile across. Dotted about the surface of the lagoon are a number of matu, tiny islets, each with its flock of sea fowl, its clump of palms, and shining beach of coral sand. Set in a lonely stretch of the Pacific, the place is almost cut off from communication with the outside world. Twice or 3 times in the course of a year, a trading schooner calls to leave supplies and take off copra. Undisturbed by contact with civilization, the life at Mataora flows on, simple, placid, and agreeably monotonous. Very little changed, I fancy, since the old days. It is true that they have a native missionary and use calico, flour, and tobacco when they can get them, but these are minor things. The great events in their annals are the outrage of the Peruvian slavers in 1862, when many of the people were carried off to labor and die in the Chinches Island, and the hurricane of 1913. After presenting myself to the missionary and the chief, I was escorted by a crowd of youngsters to the lagoon side of the island, where Terry lived, in a spot cooled by the trade wind and pleasantly shaded by coconuts. The old chap was a warm friend of Johnson's and made me welcome. I soon arranged to put up with him during my stay on the island. His house, like all the Matora houses, was worth a bit of study. Pandunus logs, 5 or 6 inches in diameter, and set 4 feet apart, made the uprights. On each side of these logs, and extending from top to bottom, a groove was cut. Thin laths, split from the aerial roots of the pandurus, were set horizontally into the grooves, making a wall which permitted the free circulation of air. At the windward end of the house, a large shutter of the same material was hung on hinges of bark. On warm days, it could be opened to admit the breeze. The plates and rafters were made of the trunks of old coconut palms, a beautiful hardwood which blackens with age and can be polished like mahogany. The roof was thatched with kakko, strips of wood over which were doubled selected leaves of pandurus, 6 feet long and 4 inches across. The cacao are laid like shingles, so deeply overlapped that only 6 inches of each is exposed, and the result is a cool and perfectly watertight roof, which lasts for years. The floor of Terry's house was a fine white gravel, covered with mats. A bed of mats, a few odds and ends of fishing gear, and a Bible in the Rotongan language made up the furniture. The old man had been a pearl diver for many years. He knew all the lagoons of this part of the Pacific, and could give the history of every large pearl discovered in these waters. 20 fathoms he considered an ordinary depth for the naked divers, 25 the limit. One day he went too deep, and since then he has been a cripple with paralyzed leg, dependent for care on the kindly people of his island. He busied himself in carving out models of the ancient Polynesian sailing canoes, beautifully shaped and polished, inlaid with shell, and provided with sails of mother-of-pearl. Now and then he presented a canoe to the captain of a trading schooner visiting the island and received in return a bag of flour or a few sticks of tobacco. I had some interesting yarns with Terry. I speak Rarotongan, and Matara language is a good deal the same. They have 3 extra consonants, by the way, the F, L, and H. What a puzzle these island dialects are. Terry told me a lot about pearl fishing. The people had divided their lagoon into 3 sections, one of which was fished each year. In this way, each section got a 2 years' rest. The shell is the object of the diving. Pearls are a secondary issue. The divers are not much afraid of sharks, but dread the tonu and the big conger eel. Some years before, when Terry was resting in a boat after a spell underwater, one of his companions failed to return to the surface. Looking through his water glass, he saw a great tonu lying on the bottom 60 feet beneath him, the legs of his comrade hanging from its jaws. Fancy the ugly brute, 10 feet long and all head, like an overgrown rock cod, with a man in his mouth. Tyree and several others seized their spears and went over the side next moment. They killed a tonu, but too late to save the life of their companion. Conger eels grow to enormous size in the pearl lagoons, and the divers keep a close watch for them. They lie in holes and crevices of the coral and dart out their heads to seize a passing fish, or the waist of a diver, stooping and intent on his task. When the conger's jaws close on wrist or ankle, the diver needs a cool head. No amount of struggling will pull the eel from his hole. One must wait quietly, Terry told me, until the conger relaxes his jaws, preparatory to taking a better grip. Then a quick wrench, and one is free. On an atoll like Matora, where the food supply is limited to fish and coconuts with a chicken or a piece of pork as an occasional treat, fishing plays a large part in the life of the people. The men were all expert fishermen and used a variety of ingenious methods to catch the different kinds of fish. Tari, of course, was no longer able to go out, but a friend of his, an old fellow named Tamatoa, used to take me with him. He was a fine specimen, 6 feet tall, muscular, and active as a boy, with clear eyes and thick gray hair. One day he proposed trying for kaparu, a small variety of mackerel. The settlement is on the lee side of the island, where a coral shoal runs out 1/2 mile to sea, covered with 20 to 40 fathoms of water. It was early in the morning, a dead calm, when we launched the big canoe and slipped out through the surf. About 1/4 mile offshore, Tamota asked me to hold the canoe stationary while he went about his fishing. Fastening a 20-foot rope to the thwart, he made a noose at the other end and passed it under his arms. Then he took a ripe coconut, split it, and gouged out the meat with his knife. With the white pulp in one hand, he slipped overboard and swam down as far as the rope would let him. Through my water-glass, I watched him put pieces of coconut into his mouth and blow out clouds of the finely chewed stuff, which drifted and eddied about him in the gentle current. He seemed to stay under indefinitely. The lungs of a pearl diver are wonderful things. Now and then he came to the surface for a fresh supply of chum, and finally, at first in twos and threes, and then in shoals, the cupperoo began to appear from the depths. Little by little he enticed them close to the surface until they swam all about him fearlessly, gobbling the morsels of coconut. At last the old man reached up for his fishing tackle, an 18-inch twig with a bit of doubled sewing cotton and a tiny barbless hook. He baited the hook with a particle of coconut and dangled it under the nose of the nearest cupperoo while he hung on the shortened rope just beneath the surface. His right arm broke water in a series of jerks, and each time it rose, a fish tumbled into the canoe until they lay in the bottom by dozens. Though the people of Mataora made sport of their work, they had plenty of leisure for other things. In the evening, when the tasks of the day had been completed by lighting the lamps in the roofed-over sleeping places of the dead, the young people loved to gather for a session of a Kautu Talanga storytelling. They met in someone's house or brought mats to spread in the bright moonlight outside, and while the others lay about intent on the tale, one after another reflected the adventures of some Polynesian hero or the loves of some legendary island princess, strange fragments from the old days, full of specters and devils and monstrous heathen gods. There was a girl named Porima who told her stories marvelously well, a tall youngster of 17, with a dash of off-island blood, Hawaiian, I think. She was an artist in her way. One could imagine in her the pioneer of a literature to come. Her broad forehead, the masses of black hair, which from time to time, with an impatient gesture, she shook back over her shoulders, and the slumberous eyes, with a suggestion of hypnotic power, made her a person not easily forgotten. Although she had told them many times, Primoria's stories never failed to hold her audience. The whispering ceased when she began, and every head turned towards where she sat, her hands continually in motion, her voice rising in excitement or dying away to a murmur, while the listeners held their breath. As the hours passed, both audience and performers used to grow weary and drop off to sleep, one by one. Finally, a rooster crowed, and one awoke with a start to realize that it was day. One evening, at a storytelling, I heard a shout from the beach and remembered that I had been invited to go after flying fish. A dozen canoes were putting out through the surf, each manned by four paddlers. I made a fourth in the last canoe. We shot out of the opening with a receding wave, paddled desperately through the surf, and a moment later were rocking gently beyond the breakers. The canoes were formed into a rough line. Each stern man lit a torch of coconut leaves bound with bark, and a man forward took his place standing, net in hand. The net is like a shallow landing net, set on a haft of stiff bamboo, and can be handled only after years of unconscious training. My position, paddling amidships, enabled me to watch how the net was managed. One doesn't often see such an exhibition of dexterity and strength. The art consists in clapping the net over the fish just at the moment when he is lying at the surface, hesitating before taking flight. At any instant, the netter may see a fish to port, to starboard, or directly ahead. Our man swung his net continually, and each time it passed over the canoe, he flipped it upside down to drop a fish. Think of the muscles needed for this sort of thing, the quickness of eye and hand, where a delicate balance must be maintained and one is constantly alert to guard one's face against the fish, which whiz past at all angles. Then remember that it is a pretty serious matter to capsize in this torch-lit water swarming with sharks, where it is imprudent even to trail one's hand overboard. In the bend of a bow-shaped islet at the north end of the lagoon, under the palms, behind a shore of blue water and dazzling sand, lived an old chap named Ruri, who introduced me to another kind of fishing. Ruri was close to 70, but a strong man still. His only complaint was lack of teeth, which compelled him to live on barabu, the grated-up meat of the young coconut, mixed with its own milk. The ambition of his life was a trip to Tahiti to get a set of false teeth. He was not a native of Matora. His mother was a Gilbert Islander and his father a Samoan. For many years, Ruri had followed the sea, cabin boy under Bully Hayes, deserter to keep a whole skin from the famous Leonora, blackbirder in the New Hebrides and Solomon Islands, pearl fisher in Penryn and the lagoons of the Pomotu. At last, on a black night of storm, his vessel struck and went to pieces on the coral of Matora, and Rory's days of wandering were over. He married a woman of the island, but now she was dead, and the old man lived alone. A mile from the settlement, occupied with his simple wants and immersed in dreams of the past. Close beside his house was the grave of his wife, a tomb of cement enclosed in a neat building of octagonal shape, with a door and a small curtained window. A fine lamp, carefully tended and lit every evening at sunset, hung above the grave, and a few stunted gardenias and frangipanias brought from enormous distances were planted about the door. Ruri's little plantation of coconuts and coarse taro was free from weeds, and the neatness of his house, shipshape and scrupulously clean, betrayed the old sailor. After a spell of calm weather, when the breaching surf had ceased to cloud the waters of the lagoon and the suspended particles of coral sand had settled to the bottom, Ruri offered to show me how to catch tinu, a fine fish inhabiting the lagoon in 10 to 20 fathoms of water, speckled like a trout on a ground of brown and gold, and reaching a weight of 20 pounds. In the absurdly complicated process of obtaining bait, tinu fishing is typical of the South Pacific. The night before, Ruri had spent 2 hours with a torch catching hermit crabs. Now, using these crabs for bait, we had to catch some kuta, a small prickly fish which alone has power to interest the tinu. We set out in Ruri's leaky canoe and paddled to a big coral mushroom, which rose to within a yard of the surface. Here the old man smashed the shells of his hermit crabs with a stone, broke off the claws, set the soft bodies to one side, and mashed the claws to a paste, which he dropped overboard and allowed to drift into a dark hole in the coral. Then he produced a short line, baited the hook with a body of a crab, and let it sink out of sight into the darkness of the hole. In 10 minutes, a dozen kuta were gasping in the bottom of the canoe. Fantastic little fish, colored scarlet and vermilion, with enormous black eyes and a dorsal fin which seemed to be carved out of red sealing wax. We put them in a basket, trailed overboard to keep them alive, and began the real fishing of the day. I paddled slowly while Ruri, who did not believe in fishing till the fish was in sight, leaned over the side, scrutinizing the bottom through his water glass. Finally, he signaled me to stop. His eyes had caught the movement of a tinu among the masses of live coral 40 feet below us. The rest was simple. One hooked a kuta under the dorsal fin, tossed him overboard, and allowed the weight of the hook and line to carry him to the bottom. By means of the water glass, one could watch the approach of the tinu, see him seize the bait, and judge the proper moment to strike. The bedino, which they call atu, is the most important of all fish to the people of Matora. Almost any fine day, one could see a fleet of canoes working offshore, busy at bonito catching, surrounded by a cloud of the seabirds which guide one to the schools. They use a pretty lure for this fishing, a sort of jig cut out of mother-of-pearl, equipped with a tuft of red-dyed coconut husk and a barbless hook of shell. Each fisherman carries a stiff bamboo rod and half a dozen of these lures, ranging in color from pale green to black, attached to 10-foot lengths of line. The islanders have discovered that the condition of the water and the variations of light make certain colors more attractive than others at a given time. And when a school is found, they try one shade after another till they discover which the bonito prefer. Then the jigs, not in use, are hooked to a ring at the base of the pole, and the fisherman begins to pull bonito from the water, heaving them out by main strength without a moment's play. The barbless hook releases itself the moment the fish is in the canoe, and the lure goes overboard without the loss of an instant. One day, after a period of low tides, I saw another method of fishing, rarely practiced nowadays, an aura, or fish-poisoning picnic. You know the Barringtonia, probably, the big tree from which they make their drums. It grows on all the high islands, and sometimes one finds it on the richer atolls. There are a few on Matora. Ever notice the flower? It is a lovely thing, a tassel of silky cream-colored stamens, shading to odd rose at the ends and tipped with golden beads. The fruit is odd-looking, like a squarish pomegranate, and it has odd properties, for when pounded up and put into shallow water, it seems to stupefy the fish. I was sitting in the shade beside Terry's house when a boy came along the settlement, blowing melancholy blasts on a conch shell, and announcing that the chief wanted everyone to be on hand that afternoon at a certain part of the lagoon, where an aura was to be held. We set out at noon, the women carrying the crushed seeds of the Barringtonia in hastily woven baskets of green coconut frond. A crowd from the other settlements was awaiting our arrival, and when the babies had been put to sleep in the shade, with small children stationed beside them to fan away flies, the fun began. A shallow stretch of lagoon lay before us, half a mile long by a quarter wide, and into this plunged the women and girls, wading and swimming in all directions, trailing behind them their baskets of poison. As time went on, a faint and curious odor began to rise from the water, a smell which reminded me vaguely of potassium cyanide. Soon the spearmen were busy, wild brown figures, naked except for scarlet loincloths, pursuing the half-stupefied fish among the crevices of the coral. Before the effect of the poison wore off and the reviving fish began to make their escape to deeper water, the men were returning to the beach, the strings of hibiscus bark at their belts loaded and dragging. On another day I joined a party of young people for a picnic across the lagoon. It was glassy calm. The water was like a mirror in which the palms of the wooded islets were reflected with motionless perfection. The beaches on the far side, invisible on an ordinary day, seemed to rise far out of water in the mirage. We landed on an uninhabited island, hauled up our canoes, and set out for a hunt of coconut crabs. They are extraordinary creatures, these crabs, enormous and delicious to eat. You will not find many on the high islands, but in a place like Matora, there are hundreds of them, and they do a lot of damage to the coconuts. During the day, they hide in their holes, deep among the roots of some big trees. At night, they come out, climb the palms, nip off the nuts with their powerful claws, descend to the ground, tear off the husk, break open the shells, and devour the meat. To catch them, one can either dig them out or build a fire at the mouth of the hole, which never fails to draw them. Fire simply fascinates the brutes. They must be handled warily, for their claws can grip like a pair of pipe tongs and shear off a man's finger without an effort. We lit a fire under the shade of a puka tree and liberated the crabs we had captured. It sounds incredible, but they walked into the fire and sat down quietly on the embers to roast. One of the boys climbed a palm and brought us some coconuts of a variety called New Mangaro, with an edible husk, sweet and fibrous, like sugar cane. After lunch, we had a swim in the deep water close inshore and lay about smoking while the girls wove us wreaths of sweet fern. It was an idyllic sort of a day. I spent 5 months on Matora. At first, when the schooner did not appear, I was worried and used to fret a little. But as time went on, I grew to like the easy-going, dreamy life, and when at last a schooner came to take me off, I didn't know whether to be glad or sorry. There were moments when I almost decided to send for a few things and follow the example of old Rory. During those 5 months, I knew more disinterested kindness than I had supposed existed in the world. My heart warmed to the people of Matara. Finally, the day came when the schooner dropped anchor in the lee of the village. Whitmore's Terria. Canoe after canoe shot out through the surf. The women gathered in the shade of the canoe houses on the beach, awaiting the landing of the boatmen, who would bring news of husbands diving for shell in distant lagoons or relatives scattered among far-off groups of islands. As I shook hands with Whitmore, I heard a prolonged wailing from the village, the tangi of a new widow. When I went to the house to get my things together, Terry informed me that as the schooner would not leave till next day, the people were preparing a farewell feast in my honor. It was held in the assembly house of the village, decorated with arches of palm frond, garlands of scented fern, and the scarlet flowers of hibiscus. Everyone brought a gift for the departing stranger, a fan, a hat, a pearl fishhook, a drinking cup of ornamented coconut shell, a carved paddle of porcupine wood inlaid with mother of pearl. I distributed what I had to offer, wishing it were a dozen times as much. On the beach next morning, the people of Matara gathered for the last hand clasp. Smile cynically, if you will. There were tears shed. I wasn't too happy myself when I heard their plaintive song of farewell floating out across the water. Worthington ceased speaking and leaned forward to scratch a match. The squall had passed long since. The immense arch of the Milky Way stretched overhead and low in the south, beyond Hull Island and Rimatora, over the longest ocean in the world. The Southern Cross was rising. Lying on mats behind us, a party of Cook Islanders spoke in soft tones, their faces illuminated fitfully by the glow of their cigarettes. My companion was lighting his pipe, and in the flame of the match I could see that he was smiling to himself. "Some day," he said, "you will hear that I have closed up my affairs and disappeared. Don't worry when that happens. You'll know I have gone to Matara, this time to stop for good." End of chapter 3. Chapter 4 of Faery Lands of the South Seas. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Mike Vendetti. Chapter 4. The Land of Ahu Ahu. I might attempt to set down a matter-of-fact description of this place if only the subject permitted one to be matter-of-fact, strange and remote, set in a lonely space of the sea and isolated from the world for the 7 or 8 centuries following the decline of Polynesian navigation. There is no other land like this hollow island of Ahu Ahu. Week after week, month after month, the watcher on its cliffs may gaze out towards the horizon and never see a sail nor a distant trail of smoke to liven the dark blue desert of the Pacific. The cliffs themselves are strange. The reef of an ancient atoll, uprised in some convulsion of the earth to form a ring of coral limestone. Sheer precipice facing the sea, 1/2 mile of level, barren summit, and an inner wall of cliffs overlooking the rich lowlands of the interior. During the unnumbered years of their occupation, this land has set a stamp upon its people, so long on Ahu Ahu that they have forgotten whence they came. Hardy, hospitable, and turbulent, they are true children of the islands, and yet a family apart, ruder and less languid than the people of Samoa or Tahiti, and speaking a harsher tongue. And more than any other island folk, they live in the past, for ghosts walk on Ahu Ahu, and the living commune nightly with the old dead who lie in the moiré. It was an hour before sunset when we sighted the land. The merest blue irregularity on the horizon, visible from one's perch in the shrouds each time the schooner rose to the crest of a sea. The mellow shout of landfall brought a score of native passengers to their feet. At such a moment one realizes the passionate devotion of the islander to his land. Men sprang into the rigging to gaze ahead with eager exclamations. Mothers held up their babies, born on distant plantations, for a first glimpse of Ahu Ahu. Seasick old women emerging from disordered heaps of matting, tottered to the bulwarks with eyes alight. The island had not been visited for 6 months, and we carried a cargo of extraordinary variety: hardware, bolts of calico, soap, lumber, jewelry, iron roofing, cement, groceries, phonograph records, an unfortunate horse, and several pigs, those inevitable deck passengers in the island trade. There were scores of cases of bully beef and ship's biscuit, and staple luxuries of modern Polynesia, and, most important of all, 6 heavy bags of mail. As we drew near the island toward midnight, I gave up the attempt to sleep in my berth and went on deck to spread a mat besides Tari, our supercargo, who lay aft of the mainmast, talking in low tones with his wife. It was calm here in the lee of the island. The schooner slipped through the water with scarcely a sound, rising and falling on the long, gentle swell. Faint puffs of air came off the land, bringing a scent of flowers and wood smoke and moist earth. We had been sighted, for lights were beginning to appear in the village. Now and then, on a flow of the breeze, one heard a sigh, long-drawn and half-inaudible, the voice of the reef. A party of natives seated on the forward hatch began to sing. The words were modern and religious, I believe, but the music, indescribably sad, wild, and stirring, carried one back through the centuries to the days when man expressed the dim yearnings of his spirit in communal song. It was a species of chant with responses. 4 girls did most of the singing, their voices mingling in barbaric harmonies, each verse ending in a prolonged melodious wail. Precisely as the last note died away in time with the cadence of the chant, the deep voices of the men took up the response. "Kari aure, no, alas." Terry turned to me. "They sing well," he said, "those Ahu Ahu people. I like to listen to them. That is a hymn, but a stranger would never suspect it. The music is pure heathen. Look at the torchlights in the village. Smell the land breeze. It would tell you you were in the islands if you were set down here blindfolded from a place 10,000 miles away. With that singing in one's ears, it is not difficult to fancy oneself in a long canoe at the end of a one-time voyage, chanting a song of thanksgiving to the gods who have brought us safely home." He is by no means the traditional supercargo of a trading schooner. This, Terry, I have wasted a good deal of time speculating as to his origin and the reasons for his choosing this mode of life. An Englishman with a hint of Oxford in his voice, quite obviously what we call a gentleman, a reader of reviews, the possessor, at his charming place in Nugatory, of an enviable collection of books on the natural history and ethnology of the South Seas. He seldom speaks of himself or of his people at home. For 20 years he has been known in this part of the world, trading on Purin, Rakitanga, Tupai, the atolls of the Palamutu. He speaks a dozen of the island dialects, can join in the singing of the Yudis, or bring a roar of applause by his skill in the dances of widely separated groups. When the war broke out, he enlisted as a private in a New Zealand battalion, and the close of hostilities found him with decorations for gallantry, the rank of captain, and the scars of honorable wounds. As a subject for conversation, the war interests him as little as his own life. But this evening he had emptied a full bottle of rum and was in the mildly mellow state which is his nearest approach to intoxication. "I never thought I'd see the old country again," he said. "But the war changed all that. I got a nasty wound in Gallipoli, you see, and they sent me home to convalesce. The family wasn't meant to know I was hurt, but they saw a bit of a thing in the paper, an account of the exploit which won Terry his DCM, and there they were at the dock when the transport offloaded. I hadn't laid eyes on them for 15 years. The old governor, by Jove, he was decent. It was all arranged that I should stop in England when the war was over. I thought myself it was a go when the job was finished, and I'd get a special dispensation to be demobbed at home. I stood it for a fortnight and then gave up. Home is all very well for a week or two, but for a steady thing, I seem to fit better down here. What is it that makes a chap stop in the islands? You must have felt it yourself, and yet it is hard to put into words. This sort of thing, perhaps, he swept his hand through the soft darkness, the beauty, the sense of remoteness, the vague and agreeable melancholy of these places. Then I, like the way the years slipped past, the pleasant monotony of life, my friends at home put up with a kind of dullness which would drive me mad. But here, where there is even less to distinguish one day from another, one seems never to grow fretful or impatient of time. One's horizon narrows, of course. I scarcely look at the newspaper any more. If you stop here, you will find yourself unconsciously drifting into the native state of mind, readjusting your sense of values until the great events of the world seem far off and unreal, and your interests are limited to your own business, the vital statistics of your island, and the odd kinds of human nature about you. Perhaps this is the way we are meant to live. At any rate, it brings serenity. I've been here too long to sentimentalize about the natives. They have their weak points, and plenty of them. Allowing for these, you'll find that the Kanakas are a good sort to have about, often amusing, always interesting, at once deep, artful, gay, simple, and childish. At bottom, they are not very different from ourselves. It is chiefly a matter of environment. Consider any of the traders who came here as boys, old fellows who will buttonhole you and spend hours abusing the people. The truth is that they have become more native than the men they abuse. There are places like Africa where one can live among a primitive people and absorb nothing from them. Their point of view is too alien, their position in the scale of humanity too widely separated from our own. It is different in the islands. If one could discover the truth, it wouldn't surprise me to learn that these people were distant cousins of ours. The scholars, in whose conclusions I have much faith, trace them back along the paths of successive migrations through Indonesia to northern India or the land of the Kushites. In any case, I believe that the blood we term Caucasian flows in their veins. The legacies of ancestors separated from the parent stocks so long ago that mankind had not yet learned the use of iron. And they are old, these island tribes, who were discovering new lands in the Pacific in the days when our forefathers wore the horns or bulls upon their heads. Don't judge them in the present, or even in the time of Cook. They were a dying people then, whose decline had begun 500 or 600 years before. It seems to me that a race, like an individual, grows old, loses heart, and fades away. On nearly every island, they are dying today, a tragedy, an inevitable one, which the coming of the European has hastened, but not caused. Whether or not it may be accounted for on grounds of a distant kinship, it is impossible to stop long in the islands without absorbing, to a certain extent, the native point of view. Things which seem rubbish at first slowly acquire significance. One begins to wonder if, after all, there may not be varieties of knowledge lost to us in the complexities of civilization. I've seen some queer things myself. My wife's mother lives on Ahu Ahu, where her ancestors have been hereditary rulers since Maui fished the island out of the sea. I've known the family a good many years, and long before I married Apakura, the old lady was kind enough to take a motherly interest in me. I always put up with her when we touched at Ahu Ahu. Once, after I had been away for several months, I sat down to have a yarn with her, and was beginning to tell about where I'd been and what I'd done, when she stopped me. "No, let me tell you," she said, with an odd smile, and upon my honor, she did, down to the details. I got the secret out of her the same evening. She is very friendly, it seems, with an ancestor of hers, a woman named Rakamona, who lived 28 generations, 700 years ago, and is buried in the big marae behind the village. When one of the family is off on a trip, and my mother-in-law suspects that he is in trouble or not behaving himself, she puts herself into a kind of trance, calls up old Rakamona, and gets all the facts. I hope the habit won't come into general use. Might prove jolly awkward, eh? Seriously, though, I can't account for the thing she told me without accepting her own explanation. Strange if there were a germ of truth in the legend of how the old sea-going canoes were navigated, the priests in a state of trance directing the helmsman which way to steer for land. There's another old woman on Ahu Ahu whose yarns are worth hearing. Many years ago, a Yankee whaling vessel called at the island, and a Portuguese harpooner, who had had trouble with the captain, deserted and hid himself in the bush. The people had taken a fancy to him and refused to give him up, so finally the captain was obliged to sail away without his man. From all accounts, this harpooner must have been a good chap when he proved that he was no common white waster. The chief gave him a bit of land and a girl of good family for a wife. Now the old lady of whom I spoke, I think it was tools he needed or some sort of gear for a house he was building. At any rate, when another whaler touched, he told his wife that he was going on a voyage to earn some money and that he might be gone a year. There was a kind of agreement current in the Pacific in those days whereby a whaling captain promised to land a man at the point where he had signed him on. Well, the harpooner sailed away, and as might have been expected, his wife never saw him again. But here comes the odd part of the story. The deserted wife, like so many of the Ahu Ahu women, had an ancestor who kept her in touch with current events. Being particularly fond of her husband, she indulged in a trance from time to time to keep herself informed of his welfare. Several months after his departure, the tragedy occurred, described in detail by the obliging and sympathetic dweller in the Moray. It was a kind of vision, as told to me, singularly vivid for an effort of pure imagination. The open Pacific, heaving gently, ruffled by a light air. Two boats from rival vessels, pursuing the same whale, the Portuguese harpooners standing in the bows of one, erect and intent upon the chase, his iron the first by a second of time to strike. Then came a glimpse of the two boats foaming side by side in the wake of the whale, the beginning of the dispute, the lancing and death flurry of an old bull sperm, the rising anger of the two harpooners as the boats rocked gently beside the floating carcass, the treacherous thrust, the long red blade of the lance standing out between the shoulders of the Portuguese. The woman awoke from her trance with a cry of anguish. Her husband was dead. She set up the widow's tangi. One might have thought it an excellent tale, concocted to save the face of a deserted wife, if the same vessel had not called at Ahu Ahu within a year, to bring news of the husband's death under the exact circumstances of the vision. What is one to believe? If seeing is believing, then count me a believer. For my own eyes have seen an incredible thing. It was on Aituaki in the Cook group. An old chief, the descendant of a very ancient family, lay ill in the village. I had turned in early, as I'd promised, to go fishing on the reef when the tide served, an hour after midnight. You know how the spirits of the dead were believed to flee westward to Hawaiki, and how their voices might be heard at night, calling to one another in the sky as they drove past high overhead. Early in the evening, as I lay in bed, a boy came into the next room, panting with excitement. He had been to a plantation in the hills, it seemed, and as he returned after dusk, had heard the voices of a shouting multitude passing in the air above him. I was tired and paid little attention to his story, but for some reason I found it impossible to sleep. It was a hot night, very still and sultry, with something in the air that made one's nerves twitch every time a coconut frond dropped in the distance. I was still lying awake when my fishing companions came to get me, a little ahead of time, for, like me, they had been unable to sleep. We would wait on the reef, they suggested, while it was sure to be cool, until the tide was right. We were sitting on the dry coral, smoking. I had just looked at my watch, I remember. It lacked a few minutes to 1 o'clock. Our canoes were hauled up on one side of the Artuka Passage. The Western Pass, by the way. There was no moon. Suddenly, one of the boys touched me. "What is that?" he exclaimed in a startled voice. I looked up. The others were rising to their feet. Two flaring lights were moving across the lagoon toward us, together and very swiftly. Nearer and nearer they came until they revealed the outlines of a canoe, larger than any built in the islands nowadays, a canoe of the old time, with a flaming torch set at prow and stern. While we stood there, staring in silence, it drew abreast of us, moving with the rush of a swift motorboat, and passed on out to sea. I was too amazed to think clearly until I heard one of the boys whisper to another, "Kuameta it akareke." The chief is dead. The great canoe bears him out to the west. We launched our canoes and crossed the lagoon to the village. Women were wailing. Yes, the old man was dead. He had drawn his last breath a little before 1 o'clock. Remember that I saw this thing myself. Perhaps it was a dream. If so, we all dreamed alike. It was late. The singing died away. The lights in the village went out one by one. The passage in the Ahu Ahu reef is a bad place by daylight. The chances were that no canoes would risk it till dawn. Terry struck a match for an instant and lay down on the mat beside his wife. In the little flare of light, I saw her sleeping in the unconscious manner of a child. I know their story, a pretty one, in pleasant contrast to the usual ignoble and transitory loves of white and brown. Apakura is the daughter of the principal family of this island, her mother and father for many years the warm friend of Tari. He had petted the child from the time she was three. She was always on the beach to meet the canoe that brought him ashore, and he, for his part, never forgot the small gift for which she waited with sparkling eyes. On his rambles about the island, little girl followed Tari with the devotion of a dog, many a time clambering along the base of the cliffs at dawn. His first knowledge of her presence came with the shrill cry of, "Taiki, my Tari!" And he waited while his small follower managed some difficult pile of coral in the rear. Their friendship had only Tari's two or three visits a year to feed on, but neither forgot. And in the course of time, as the child learned to read and write, a correspondence began, very serious on her side, pleased and amused on his. When he went away to the war, she was 11, a slim, dark-eyed child. When he returned, she was 16 and a woman, though he did not know it. On this occasion in the evening, when the rest of the family had gone to bed, he sat talking with Apakura's mother, or rather, listening, while the old woman told one of her stories of life on Ahu Ahu, equally fascinating and long drawn out. It is not difficult to reconstruct the scene in imagination. Tari, comfortable in bare feet, and Apamburu half reclining against the wall as he smoked his pipe in absent-minded puffs. The woman, cross-legged on the floor, leaning forward in earnest speech, her voice rising, falling, and dying to a whisper in the extraordinary manner of the Polynesian teller of tales, her hands from time to time falling simultaneously with a loud slap to her knees in emphasis of some point in the narrative. The story ended. Little by little, the mother led the conversation to the subject of her daughter. Terry began to praise the girl. "What do you think of her?" asked the old woman. "Now that you have been away these 5 years." "There is no other girl like her," said Tari. "Since that is so, take her with you. We shall be pleased, all of us, I in particular, who look on you as a son. She is a good girl. She can sew, she can cook, and the young men say that she is beautiful." "You propose that I take her as a wife?" exclaimed the astonished Tari, to whom, in truth, the idea had not occurred. "Yes, why not? You need a wife, now that the little affair of Tukanani has blown over." "But think, Mama, I am 40 and the child is 16. It is not fitting." "Young wives are best if they are faithful. Apakura will never look at another man." "I will think it over," said Tari. "Let us leave it so. Not this year, at any rate. She is too young." As he bade her good night and turned to go to his sleeping place, the old woman spoke again. "Bear one thing in mind," she said, with a smile. "It will help you to decide. Consider now and then the thought of my daughter married to another." In the end, as is often the case, it was Apakura who settled the matter. Next morning, Terry was busy with some stock taking and did not board the schooner till the last moment or notice. In his preoccupation, the mysterious smiles with which the crew greeted him, they were a dozen miles offshore before he folded the last of his papers, lit a pipe, and went on deck for a breath of air. The old woman's last words stuck unpleasantly in his mind, I fancy, as he stood there smoking with his back to the companionway. All at once he saw the helmsman, an Ahu Ahu boy he had known since childhood, lift his eyes from the binnacle and grin from ear to ear. At the same moment, Terry felt a hand slip into his own and heard a small, familiar voice say, "I'm here." It was Apakura, more serious than usual and a little frightened, but not to be put off longer. They were married in Tahiti a fortnight later. It was Apakura's voice that awakened me. She was leaning over the bulwark in eager conversation with her mother, who had come off in the first canoe. The air was fresh with the cool dawn. In the east, the sky was flushing behind scattered banks of trade wind clouds, tinted in wonderfully delicate shades of terracotta. A dozen big outrigger canoes of the type peculiar to this island were coming out through the passage, each paddled by four men, who shouted as their heavy craft dashed through the breakers. Little by little, not at all after the manner of traditional dawn in the tropics, the light increased until Ahu Ahu lay fully revealed before us. The smoking reef, the shallow lagoon, and the cliffs, their summits plumed with coconut palms. A crowd of islanders was already gathering on the reef, and I could see others making their way down the steep path from the settlement. As the sun rose, the colors of the scene grew stronger. Green palms, gray cliffs, white walls of the village, pale blue of the sky, azure of the sea water. There is no color in the world that I have seen like the blue of the water off the Ahu Ahu reef. So vivid, so intense, one felt that a tumbler of it held up to the sun would be a mass of sapphire, or that a handkerchief dipped in it would emerge strongly dyed. Apakura was going ashore with her mother. Standing in the narrow canoe, she directed the stowing of her luggage, a mat, a bright patchwork quilt, a box of cedar wood. Terry was awaiting the coming of the traders, for the schooner was stocked with good Tahiti rum, and the rites of welcome would take place on board. "There they are," he said, pointing to two white figures, wading gingerly across the shallow lagoon to the reef. "You're going to meet a pair of rare ones. They've been hard doers in their time." The distant figures reached the edge of the boat passage, and I could see a boy beckoning them into a waiting canoe. But now they stopped and seemed to argue with many gestures. Terry chuckled. "No use trying to hurry them," he told me. "They are discussing the loss of the Esperanza. She went ashore here in the late 90s, a full-rigged ship. Peter was one of her crew. Charlie had just come here to trade and saw the whole thing. They've spent 20 years thrashing out the question of whether or not the wreck might have been avoided. Every morning after breakfast, Charlie strolls across to Peter's house to smoke a pipe and discuss some of the fine points. Every evening after tea, Peter returns the visit, and the argument goes on till bedtime. Charlie's an American, an old man now, close to 70. He put in 30 years on Hivaoa in the Marquesas before he came to Ahu Ahu. I'd like to have some of his memories. Notice his arms if he pulls his sleeves up. He has 16 children in Hivaoa and 14 here, all numbered. He says he never can remember their heathen names. When his wife died in the north, he gave all his land to the children and left on the first schooner. She touched at Papeete, but he didn't go ashore. Then she made Ahu Ahu, where he landed and established himself a second time. He has never seen a motor car, a telephone, or an electric light. Presently the canoe came dancing alongside, and the two old men clambered painfully over the rail. Peter, thin, hatchet-faced, stooping, Charlie the ruin of a magnificent man, he towered above any of us on the deck. This ancient dweller among cannibals, still erect, his head still carried proudly, but the flesh hanging loose and withered on his bones. It was easy to fancy the admiration he must have inspired 40 years ago among the wild people in whose eyes physical strength and perfection were the great qualities of a man. In the cabin, while the cook squeezed limes for the first of many rum punches, Charlie took off his tunic of white dill, and as he sat there in his singlet, I saw that his arms and chest, like his face, were tanned to an incredible dull brown, and that patterns of tattooing ran from wrist to shoulder, greenish-blue and barbaric. I never learned his history. It must have been a thing to stir the imagination. Once, as we sat drinking, Tari mentioned Stevenson, and the old man's face brightened. "Yee," he said slowly in native fashion. "I remember him well. He came to Hiva Ora with the Casco. A funny fellow he was. Thin. There was nothing to him but skin and bones, and questions he'd ask you 100 in a minute. I didn't take to him at first, but he was all right. I didn't care how he dressed. One day I saw him walking on the beach with nothing on but a pair of drawers." The cook plied back and forth, removing empty glasses and bringing full ones. As each tray was set on the table, Peter, typical of a lively and garrulous old age, seized his glass and held it up.
"Hurrah!" he explained. "Down she goes," drawled Charlie, and
Terry murmured,
"Cheerio!"
At the end of 2 hours, Charlie's eyes were beginning to glaze, and Peter was mumbling vaguely of the Esperanza. Terry rose and beckoned to me.
"Make yourselves at home," he said to the old man.
"I've got to go ashore. Akatora will give you lunch whenever you want it." As our canoe made for the reef, my companion told me there was to be a feast in his honor and that his wife wished me to be present. We shot into the passage without a wedding. The people crowded about Terry, laughing, shaking his hand, speaking all at once, an unmistakable warmth of welcome. The settlement, reached by a short, steep trail, lies at the base of a break in the cliffs. At the door of her mother's house, Apakura Metis turned out, as becomes a supercargo's wife, in the choicest of trade finery. She wore heavy golden earrings, bands of gold were on her fingers, and her loose frock was of pale embroidered silk. Her mother, the keen-eyed old woman I had seen in the canoe, made me welcome. In the afternoon, when the feast was over and we rose stiffly, crammed with fish and taro and baked pig, I asked Terry if he knew a youngster who would show me the best path to the interior of the island. A boy of 10 was soon at the door, a dark-skinned child with a great shock of hair and legs disfigured by scars of old coral cuts. A twisting path, cobbled and wide enough to walk 2 abreast, led us to the summit. The stones were worn smooth by the passage of bare feet, for, excepting fish, all the food of the village is brought over this road from the plantations to the sea. There could be no doubt that the ring of cliffs on which we stood was an ancient reef. In places, one could recognize the forms of coral embedded with shells of many varieties in the metamorphosed rock. Here and there, one found pockets of a material resembling marble, veined and crystalline, formed from the coral by processes impossible to surmise. The bulk of the rock is the fine-grained white limestone called Makatera in the eastern Pacific. The level summit of the cliffs over which, in centuries gone by, the sea had washed and thundered, forms a narrow path, sparsely wooded and cultivated in spots where a thin soil has gathered in the hollows. We halted under one of the palms crowning the inner brink. The trail wound down giddily ahead, so steep in places that ladders had been fastened to the rock. To right and left of us, the cliffs were sheer walls of limestone, rising from a level little above that of the sea. The low hills of the interior, volcanic and firm-covered, draining in every direction toward the foot of the Makaria, have formed a circling belt of swampland on which all the taro of the island was grown. One could look down on the beds from where we stood, a mosaic of pale green laid out by heathen engineers in days beyond the traditions of men. Another time, perhaps, I will tell you of that afternoon, how we climbed down the trail and walked the dikes among the taro, how my escort increased to a merry company as the people began to come after food for the evening meal, of a boisterous swim in a pool beneath a waterfall, of how I found the remains of an ancient house built of squared stone so long ago that over one end of it the wooded earth lay 2 yards deep. Toward evening, in the bush at the edge of the taro swamps, I came upon a large house built of bamboo and pandalus in the native fashion. A man was standing framed in the doorway, a tall white man, dressed in pajamas of silk. His gold-rimmed spectacles, gray beard, and expression of intelligent kindness were vaguely academic, out of place, as the cultivated voice which invited me to stop. The boys and girls escorting me squatted on their heels outside. A brace of pretty children, shy and half-naked, scurried past as I entered the house. My host waved his hand toward a mat. There was only one chair in the room, standing before a table on which I saw a small typewriter and a distorted heap of manuscript. Otherwise, the place was unfurnished except for books, ranged in crude bookcases, tier upon tier, stacked here and there in precarious piles, standing in rows along the floor. "I'm glad to see you," he said, as he offered me a cigarette from a case of basketwork silver. "It is not often that a European passes my house. I shall not give his name or attempt to disguise him with a fictitious one. It is enough to say that he is one of the handful of real scholars who have devoted their lives to Polynesian research. I had read his books, published long before, and wondered more than once whether he still lived and where he hid himself. The years of silence had been spent, he told me, in a comparative study of the ocean dialects through which he hoped to solve the riddle of the Pacific, to determine whence came the brown and straight-haired people of the islands. Now, with the material in hand, he had chosen Ahu Ahu as a place of solitude where he might complete his task of compilation undisturbed. On the whole, he said, with agreeable readiness to speak of his work, I am convinced that they came from the West. The Frenchman's theory that the race originated in New Zealand, like the belief that they migrated westward from the shores of America, is more picturesque, more stirring to the imagination, but the evidence is too vague. If one investigates the possibilities of an eastward migration, on the other hand, one finds everywhere in the Western Islands the traces of their passage. Far out in the Orient, in isolated groups of the coast of Sumatra, about Java, and the Celebes, in the Arafura Sea, I can show you people of the true Polynesian type. Even in such places where the last migration must have passed nearly 2,000 years ago, scraps of evidence remain. A word, a curious custom, the manner of carrying a basket. These things might seem coincidences if the trail did not grow warmer as one travels east. Though no trace of their blood is left, New Guinea must at one time have been a halting place in the migration. Papua, it is called, and one finds the word current in Polynesia, meaning a garden, a rich land. The natives of New Guinea are as unlike the people of the eastern Pacific, I should say, as the average American or Englishman, and yet throughout New Guinea there is a most curious cropping out of Polynesian words, pointing to a very ancient intercourse between the races. Consider the word for woman among the Polynesians. In Rarotonga, it is Vian. In Tahiti, Vahine. In Marquise, Vihin. In Hawaii, Vahine. In Samoan, Vafane. The same root runs through the dialects of Papua. In Matu, woman is Hibine. In Kapurununu, Varvine. In Amorne, Barbine, and in Montagu, it is Va, which in this part of the Pacific means variously female, seed, and rain. I can cite you dozens of similar examples. Now and then one comes across something that sets one's imagination to work. As you must know, the word for sun in the islands is Ra. But in Tahiti, they have another word, Mahana. In New Guinea, 3,500 miles away, and with all Melanesia between, the tribes of South Cape call the sun Mahana. What a puzzle it is. Though it may be the merest coincidences that Ra has a flavor of Egypt, I wonder if there could be a connection. I used to know a girl in Tahiti whose strange and rather beautiful name, hereditary as far back as the records of her family went, was that of a queen of Egypt, who ruled many hundreds of years before Christ. But I mustn't ride Mojave too fast. It is a pity you can't stop on Ahu Ahu for a time. There are not many islands so unspoiled. I've grown very fond of the place. I doubt if I ever leave it permanently. If you are interested in ghosts, you had better change your mind. I have a fine collection here. The house is built on the site of a tumble-down marae. There is our white rooster, the spirit of an old chief, which appears during the new moon, perfectly harmless and friendly, but the people rather dread him. Then we have a ghostly pig, very bad indeed, and a pair of malignant women who walk about at night with arms and long hair entwined, and are suspected of ghastly appetites. I shall not say whether or not I have seen any of these. Perhaps it is living too much alone, but I am not so skeptical as I was. It was not easy to part with such a host, but the sun was low over the Marica, and the prospect of crossing the dikes among the taro and scaling the cliff by dark drove me at last to take reluctant leave. Lamps were shining in the village when I returned. In some of the houses I heard the voice of the father reading aloud solemnly from the Bible in the native tongue. In others, the people were assembled to chant their savage and melancholy hymns. Tari was alone on the veranda, smoking in his absent-minded fashion, and motioned me to sit down beside him. I told him how I had spent the afternoon. When I had finished, he puffed on in silence for a time. "It is a strange place, Ahu Ahu," he said at last. "My mother-in-law has finished her prayers, sung her hymnes, and put away the family Bible. Now she has gone to the house of one of her pals for a session with old Rakamona. Like the land itself, the people are relics of an elder time, pure heathen at heart." End of chapter 4.